She don't remember me, don't remember me. She don't remember me. She don't remember me, don't remember me. Don't remember me.
Oh, it was pretty. What's going on, guys? This is Mehul, and right now I am here joined with the multi-platinum producer, Parker Ighile. What's going on, bro?
How's it going? Good to see you, man.
It's going good, it's going good. Well, bro, listen, we go back a long way.
You've got to tell them how far we go back.
Alright, so we go back probably what? What is it? It's coming up to what? 14 years since we went to school together.
We went to high school together. Mehul was actually in my form in high school.
Yeah.
So we were in high school for 4 years because where we grew up, you actually start high school in year eight.
Year eight, yeah.
So it was year 8, 9, 10, and 11. So I saw this guy every day for 4 years, and I'm at a place in my life where I really don't like doing interviews. But I thought, if it's Mehul, like, what the hell, let's do it. It can't be that bad. So. Yeah, it's good to see you, man. Beneath the silence, I hear victory
beneath the silence. Flaming the ocean. But what were your sort of influences growing up? What were you sort of listening to? What influenced you to kind of like make the beats that you're doing now?
I think different things influence me at different stages. So I'll say the kind of attitude I have towards music is probably influenced by like the grime scene,
yeah.
Wiley, like when he dropped Eskimo and things like that. It's like the whole attitude that I got from listening to that music and their work ethic is my attitude towards music now. In terms of the music itself, it's like my parents used to play like Fela and Sade, and my sister would play like TLC and 3T, Michael Jackson, and my cousins would play like gospel music. So creatively and like in terms of the music itself, I guess it comes from a load of different things, but the attitude and the work ethic is definitely from, you know, from London and from the scene that I came up in, you know. So
definitely. And talking about the scene, you did grow up under the name Pistol P.
Yeah.
Spitting grime, over grime beats back in the day. What kind of led you to kind of almost stop that and focus a bit more producing, especially in the early stage?
It's not that I stopped. It's that I always wanted to make music. And I didn't necessarily want to be an MC. It's just how I expressed myself at the time. And I never saw it as, this is the only thing I can do. It was just, this is what I like doing right now. So I actually produced before I started MCing because we didn't have beats to MC on. So it was like, before we write lyrics, we might as well make some beats.
Yeah.
So when I was little, I had a little laptop with my homie and we would make beats. And then that kind of like went into the background and I started MCing.
I want to take it back, October 2009. That's a big moment in your career. Chip dropped Oopsie Daisy, went to number one. How did that record on the sort of effect, impact on your career, your life?
In terms of my life, it kind of like put us on the map in terms of like just the industry.
Yeah.
So at the time I was part of a production outfit called Parker and Link. It was me and my friend, my close friend at the time, Carl James. And we went from like making beats in a studio in Kilburn, broke, jumping train barriers to like making beats in a studio in Kilburn with like loads of money and like everyone asking us to work with them, essentially. So it's like life definitely changed, was definitely gave us the freedom to make music, because that's what it was about. Like,
that's it.
We weren't trying to like do anything. We didn't have like kids or families or anything. So it's just like, we want to make music. So when we got the success and everything, it just put us in a position to make music and get our music out there. Oops,
here we go again. You messed up once, I messed up twice. But how many times are we gonna try again? Success came for you quite quick after that. Everyone wanted to get in the studio with you.
Mm-hmm.
Year later. Like a brother, do it like a dude. Grab my crutch, wear my hat low like you. Do it like a brother, do it like a dude. Grab my crutch,
good, pretty damn good. And yeah, we did that with The Invisible Man. Yeah. Like my friend, good friend of mine, George Estacio, who's part of Invisible Man. Yeah, they did that track and co-wrote it with Jessie, and we kind of helped with the production. And it was just, I don't know, I can't say how, I can't really explain how that happened. And I think what she went on to do kind of made that look amazing, you know?
Yeah.
So it was just, it's dope to get to work with someone who's like one of the best that's come out of our country, to be like one of the first records that kind of set her off. It's fucking cool.
Mad.
Yeah. And that beat actually was for Chip as well.
It was?
Yeah, he had like some lyrics on it.
I remember a Facebook thing, I remember it.
And then they were like, oh, we're using this for Jesse. And they hit me up and I had to make that phone call like, yo, bro, like, you heard of Jesse J? Like, she kind of wants that beat. And he's like, oh, you're killing me, man. But then, yeah, you know, he looked out for me on that one. So, you know, that's good.
But you know what? 2012, I think that was around the time you signed with Nicki on her label, being the first sort of artist. How did that kind of come about?
Well, Nicki is into a lot of music and she hears a lot of things that you guys probably don't expect she hears. She just doesn't go on about it, you know, but she's got a good ear for music. And my manager, F.A.O. Benny, is good friends with her manager, G. Robeson. And you know, they share music, you know, like, we actually enjoy the music we make, so it's like, we want to send it to our friends and stuff like that. So he got the record and he showed it to Nicki, and Nicki was like, she fucks with it. And I was living in Atlanta with F.A. at the time. She came through on her tour. She had a show at the Fox Theater. She was like, come and watch the show. Yeah. I was there, I watched the show. I was like, oh my God, this is crazy. Yeah. Like, the performance was insane. And then she was like, oh, I'll come backstage after. I came. I was like kicking it with her, and she was like, yeah, I wanna, you know, wanna fuck with you, wanna like, you know, help you out with what you're doing. I was like, for sure. I'd met a lot of people, like I met everyone. Mm. Like most artists you would wanna sign to.
Yeah.
And it was like, out of everyone I met, it was like, she was the realest person I met that was just like, didn't wanna change anything about what I was doing. I was just gonna let me do what I wanna do. And you can see she's done that.
Definitely.
Like, I haven't put anything out in ages, but she's like, she's letting me do it the way I want to do it, you know?
Definitely. Well, talking about not putting music out for ages, your Twitter, your Instagram, all I see is from your fans going, Parker, when are you going to drop your new record? When are you going to drop your new music? When is that, man? Because it's been quite a while, if you think about it, since So Beautiful and all that stuff.
I got a lot of dope music, and I'm at a stage where I'm quite fit. Like, music is like anything, like a sport, basketball, football. It's like you gotta practice to get to that stage where you're like consistent. And yeah, I'm quite fit now, so I can put out music, but it's not about me pushing this music on myself. I'm from a place where there are a lot of musicians and there's people I believe in, and there's artists I wanna push and develop before I say, no, I'm not doing any of that anymore, and I'm focusing on me. So I'm not in any rush to put out music, because I've never tried to make music that sounds like anyone else. So you can't like say, oh, shit sounds old now.
Yeah.
It's like, I never made it for that purpose in the first place. Like, my music is just like little pieces of time.
Definitely.
I think you can feel that, so.
No, I'ma treat you real different. One time, you know I love it when we kick it. You got a girl and she looks just like a mother. You better tuck her in, it's going down tonight. And I'ma give you what I'll give no other. Cause this ain't love if we can't love for life.
Well, you know what? Speaking of Grace, she's killing it at the moment. There's this one guy, the legend, and I think you know who I'm going to ask you about.
The Godfather.
The Godfather, probably the greatest producer of
all time.
Mm-hmm. I see him shouting you out on Instagram, something like that. You're a bit of a mentor. He's a bit of a mentor to you.
He's definitely a mentor to me. Quincy Jones.
Yeah.
The man himself. What do you want to know?
man, like, what everyone knows is everything. It like to work with him, considering he's probably made timeless, timeless music? What bit of nuggets of advice has he been giving to you? What are you learning off him?
I can't share the good bits of
it.
Because that's not why.
Oh.
I can't give away the secrets, but definitely the most amazing experience ever. Quincy's just, he's been around for a long time.
Yeah.
I can't even explain to you, so we're talking about back with Frank Sinatra to Michael Jackson, like, to, he's still around, he's still here.
The record number of Grammy nominations.
Like, so many people, sorry to say this, have been, and they've come, and they've gone. Achieved great things, and they've gone, and Quincy's still here.
That's it.
And when you meet him, within the first 5 minutes, you will understand why.
Yeah?
And, yeah, he's wise. He's like, Quincy's like Yoda.
Like, you've compared him to Yoda.
Quincy is wise beyond belief and sharp. He's 81, 82 years old. Sharp, like super sharp. Multiple languages, humorous, funny as hell. Like, great experience. But it was his idea to do the song, to do the record. He was like, I did this record way back when with a girl called Leslie Ball, and I think you guys should remake the record.
Yeah.
And FA and I started working with Grace, and we said, why don't we do it with Grace? He's like, yeah, do it with Grace. And that was it. Cool.
Well, do you know what? You're so successful. You see a lot of people now wanting to produce.
Mm-hmm.
What advice would you give them to sort of get started?
To get started, I think research into the four stages of learning. I'm not going to go into it now, but it's basically just learn all there is to know. So you know what you don't know. So like, if you're doing something bad, at least you know I'm doing something bad. And then just work towards that, and just try to always know more. Even if you don't know everything about the particular subject, know that there is a subject that I don't know about.
Yeah.
You know, do you get what I'm saying?
Kind of, yeah.
Because like, some rappers rap and then they don't know about like lyrical content.
Yeah, definitely.
They're just writing. They're just trying to rhyme.
That's fine.
And then there's some people who are just trying to write content and they don't really consider rhyme.
Yes.
So you got to know like everything you have to work with, and then you can try and get better at
definitely.
These things. Yep. And you know, it's like on fucking FIFA, you have the players and it's like shooting 86 and passing 10, or you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
You gotta know like what all those attributes are to be an artist, or to
definitely.
Be a producer or a singer, and you just gotta work at everything. So I think that's it. It's not about equipment or what program, Fruity Loops and Pro Tools and Logic and all that stuff. It's just about you and the choices you make when you're making music and stuff like that. So yeah, that's the only advice, you know. If I had to give one piece of advice, that would be it.
Well, do you know what, Parker? Thanks for chatting with me today. You know you're an inspiration to a lot of people out there.
Thank you so much.
Best of luck in everything that you've got coming out for the future. I know you're going to kill it.
Thank you, man. We got to kick it as well. We got to kick it before I leave town.
Definitely, man. Definitely.
All right, bro. Thank you.
Cool.
You are so beautiful to me.